All right. Yep. Nobody saw that coming.
Yep, that's it.
Couldn't have thought of something like that happening. Five.
Four.
Three.
Two.
And one.
One.
Hello, world, hear the song that we're singing. Come on, get happy.
Ladies and gentlemen, mesdames, messieurs, bienvenue, welcome to the Happy Hour.
Welcome back, Happy Hour listeners. That was quite a riveting game against the freaking Tortorella Flyers.
Oh my god.
Jesus.
Sorry.
Christ. My word. As anyone that was actually watching the game, if you stayed awake during it, actually ended on time because nothing was happening. I think it ended at like 9:25.
Yeah.
I don't know if there's a record about like the shortest full regulation game in hockey history, but
Angela Price would have been happy.
Angela Price would have been happy.
Why?
She used to, back when I followed her on Instagram, she would complain all the time about late games and stuff.
Oh,
the kids.
Oh, that's so hard with your multimedia campaign and multimillionaire husband. It's so hard. It reminds me of the South Park episode that
I can hear you.
Okay.
It reminds me of the South Park episode that the royal couple didn't like, that you have to watch, Veronica. I watched it again this weekend. It was amazing. Prince
the
Harry.
The only reason I know that it's funny, but it annoys
me. Oh, it stabs them.
All the stupid assholes who actually believe it.
It murders them. Oh, I'm pretty sure the creators of South Park do not give a flying F.
Oh no, they don't care. They don't care.
Well, no, I mean, they would think the world would be a better place without her. But I could be wrong. My name's David Ogier at Glaucus123 on Twitter.com. Joined as always by Beth.
Hello, I'm at HIVERHUIT on Twitter.
And Veronica.
Yeah, I'm at CHILE underscore pepper on all the platforms.
And this is the Happy Hour, only on select platforms that I'm about to list out for you. At Happy Hour on Twitter, Happy Hour Pod on Instagram, youtube.com/happyhour, and happyhour.com. Yeah, so we're recording this after the game against the Flyers, and holy crap. Whatever. The best part about that game was Brendan Gallagher netting his 201st goal in the National Hockey League. Fifth round pick back in 1972. It's just amazing the longevity of Brendan Gallagher through these years.
I wonder what year was that? Like 20.
Okay, was so actually wait, drafted.
We're in the same year. I was 18 in 2010.
I was going to say 2010.
I think 2010.
Galley in 2010?
I think so. Hey, Google, what year was Brendan Gallagher drafted?
Oh, my God.
Downtime is
off, which means I can't. Fuck you, Google. God damn it.
Okay. Of course he's not. Of course Google's not going to know that. No, I just typed it in, 2010.
What year was Brendan Gallagher drafted into the NHL?
I just typed it in, it's 2010.
He's like a month. A month and a half younger than me.
In the fifth round of the 2010 NHL draft.
Why is your watch an Aussie?
He's an Aussie dude. It's the best. I have the Indian woman too. I love her too.
Jesus.
But right now it's an Aussie dude.
All right. Well, anyways, 201 for Brendan Gallagher. He's on a 3-game goal streak, it seems. Oh, if that was a streak, I think I got that right. And we have about 5 games to talk about since the last time we recorded. Just talking about the Philadelphia one because it sucked. It was lame.
Yeah.
Congratulations to Sean Farrell. Whoever he is. Bit of a ghost in the game, even though he was slotted in on the second line. Besides, oh boy, who did they?
Pezzetta and
Grianov.
No, not so? Pezzetta on the second line.
Oh, Grianov though.
I mean, who's centering now that Doc's out? Fucking Drouin. That's right.
Did they move him up? I'm bad with when they change lines because it.
I'm just talking about what Twitter said that the starting lineup would be, and yeah. He was slotted. Oh. It was
okay. I missed that. I saw Eric Engel saying that he was going to be with Bill Zeal and Pizzetta.
Oh well, Eric Engel's lies, and he actually doesn't work for the team.
Okay, so also it was apparently what Marty said during the presser before the game, but Marty lied about two things during that presser. Apparently,
yeah, so. We get so much information now; it's great if we get this blatant breaking information as it comes. Because what was it? Oh yeah, they said that that tourney was going to be a healthy stretch.
Sitting for Doc. Yeah.
And then like an hour later, like Kirby Doc's injured. Chris Tierney's taking his place. It's like oh. And something funny that one of our friends, I think a mutual friend on Twitter, mentioned, like, oh, God, the injury spread from his lower body to his upper body for Kirby Doc. If you recall, flu-like symptoms in his lower body, whatever the fuck that weird presser was.
He had an illness that came from his lower body injury.
Right. And
a hernia will cause that.
I mean, we didn't need to know any of it.
Yeah.
No. Injured, out.
Yeah, he's just out.
He's in one piece. If he's in different pieces, that would be useful to know.
That would be pertinent information.
It's like upper body injury, two pieces. What? What do you mean? So, like fucking Crosby.
Like when the Matryoshka doll. The Russian dolls that...
Oh.
I think it was during last night's game that Engels said that... something had happened to him in the third period, and that's why he didn't.
Oh yeah, he got cross-checked in the back of the head from behind. Yeah, he's not going to be well. He went to the concussion protocol, but then he played in overtime. But then he went out, and then he was out
during overtime. I was at work until 11 p.m.
The fuck was I doing? Oh yeah, I was coming back from Canada because it was my birthday weekend.
Dave's debauchery week.
Oh yeah, let me tell you, I'm pretty sure I put a stripper through college this past weekend. My God, just
good. It's your good deed.
I know it's my good deed. Now I don't have to do shit for the rest of the year. It's amazing. You're welcome, Sasha. Anyway, Shea Prairie is a lot of fun. Bring your kids. No, don't do that. But you know, just it's a family affair. It's fine. It's fun. It's fun. It's great. It's awesome time. Get there at like 10. Oh my God, nobody's there. It's amazing. So much attention. Anyways, we had so many games, so much news as well. So let's go through the news stuff before we get into the games. Big pizza news, Josh Anderson out for the rest of the season. That was, if anybody thought different from how his foot looked like a Play-Doh gummy when it hit the post there after Sergachev threw him down. That was ridiculous. That Tampa Bay Lightning game. Speaking of, I guess we'll talk about the game anyway. The Lightning looked terrible. And I can only hope that they put it together with all of the press being like, oh, they look friggin' awful.
Get it together.
Only to then defeat the Leafs in a sweep.
And then they can get out. It's fine.
They better get it together.
They better get together against the Leafs.
I'm going to hold Sergachev's cat hostage until...
There you go.
The end.
There you go.
I can't wait. I can't wait to see Jack Eye avenge.
Oh yeah,
Josh.
Yeah, that's gonna be next season is gonna be the revenge tour.
I felt pretty good because the day before that game, we were talking about Drouin and Sergachev, and I said Sergachev's a dick. He's an asshole. So I'm glad we don't have him. And then he proved me right. He's a fucking dick.
Yeah, he's a fucking goon, piece of shit.
Yeah.
Speaking of, Drouin scored in that game as well.
Yep.
Second of the season. Good for him.
It's his birthday today. He is 28.
Nice. Happy birthday,
Drouin. All he has to do is be 2 minutes late to a meeting, have his coach drag him for 3 days.
Oh, yeah.
Nailed to the bench for an entire game, and then...
Yeah.
And he hasn't done a thing since, I don't think. I don't know. I haven't looked at the stats completely yet. Oh, well.
Can I say something?
Sure. It's a podcast.
About that? About Drouin? I had been meaning to... I haven't been listening to TSN 690 live on the air for a while now. Just because I've got too much fucking work to do during the day, but I had been meaning to go back and listen to Aaron Ward's hits on Melnick.
Aaron Ward, yes.
Particularly because Aaron Ward has a gay kid. And so I wanted to see what his thoughts were on all of that fucking Rhymer and all that shit. And so his thoughts on that were great, but he also, the thoughts that he had on the whole Drouin debacle that we were like kind of going like, what the hell is going on and everything last week. He just said, St. Louis did the exact right thing. He said, all of the kids in that room are looking to see how a veteran who does this shit gets treated when he's 2 minutes late. And he did the exact right thing. He held him accountable. He didn't let him get away with it. He, you know, just did all of the right things, because yeah, that's how, you know, the younger kids are going to have respect for the coach. And that's when he talked about how Sutter is losing Calgary or has lost the Flames. That was his opinion on that. But he said it was all, Marty St. Louis handled that exactly perfectly from a player perspective, and that Drouin should have expected that as well.
Good. God damn it.
Yeah.
So there.
So we were all like, why? Well, it's because he has to set a precedent that,
yeah,
veterans are not going to be able to get away with this. And that was one of the complaints too, out of Montreal, out of, you know, despite how much everybody shat on Michel Therrien, he let PK get away with shit.
And oh, yeah.
Teammates don't like it.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. I have firsthand accounts from a player that played with him that was very much like, he's a prima donna piece of shit. And we agree with that. Absolutely.
Yeah.
So good. So speaking of players and holding them accountable, Gouley, I can't believe the Montreal medical team allowed this to happen. Gouley's out for the remainder of the season with a high knee sprain, while Anderson, as we mentioned, a high ankle sprain, both of which do not require surgery. They just got to sit around at home and, you know, chill out for a bit. And I can't believe the medical staff allowed this to happen, especially when Dr. Mulder, during the Tampa game, came out onto the ice with a shovel and smacked Kirby Dach in the back of the head. I was shocked. I couldn't believe that would happen. No other team would allow this from their medical staff. I can't believe they had him sit the game after. Absolutely insane. Absolutely insane. I would never have do that. Never have done that as a medical professional working for a fucking hockey team. Man, if I hear any more of that storyline,
never read the replies.
I have a fucking board and points on a wall that's like, you said something about the medical team for the Habs? What a shame. That is shameful. Anyway.
I think it was after the Tampa game that I was listening to the post-game show, and it was Mitch or Sean.
And Sean was like, I can't believe. No, I don't know.
No, they're both like, we are so over all of the fucking medical doctors on Habs Twitter. It's just like.
Good. We should be on the post game show.
Yeah.
That's like, it's pretty much the Habby hour with fans.
Yeah.
or at least live, I should say. We'll do a live show sometime. I'll figure out the tech for it.
Jesus Christ.
It's probably hard.
Mm. Okay, what else happened? Because Dach and Gallagher are coming back, so Anthony Richard goes back to the Rocket. The Rocket, by the way, not the Veer, hard left. They are in the fight of their lives getting into the playoffs. Mentioned it last week. It's still apparent this week. There is a three-team race for the last slot in the North Division for the playoffs, and the Rocket are in a dead heat with that, with the Cleveland Monsters and the...
Syracuse Crunch.
New Brunswick Admiral Pusses. I have no idea who the fuck they are. Admiral Pusses? Bridgeport, actually? I could be wrong.
Okay.
Oh, wait a second. Oh, the Belleville Senators. That's who they are. My bad.
Oh.
I forgot they existed. So, easily anyways. Done. I mean, the Rocket are actually playing a game tonight against the Manitoba Moose. It is in the third period.
They're doing pretty good.
Third period currently, 4-2 for the Rocket. Emil Heinemann with two goals tonight for the Rocket.
We love Emil.
He's a bit of a guy's a bit of a, you know, he plays. You know, he's either very savvy, just, or he's getting lucky, but whatever it is, I think he's on a 2 or 3 game goal streak.
Good for him.
Again, we are not an AHL podcast. We are the Habs podcast.
Ooh. Yeah, I think you shared this, Beth.
Yes, in the chat. That's what I got excited about right before we started.
Jeff Gordon, aussi dit que les négociations avec Cole Caulfield se déroulent bien, et se dit confiant que le dossier va continuer de bien évoluer, avec un petit sourire.
Évoluer.
Okay, what's the translate tweet?
Yep.
Jeff Gordon also said,
going well.
That negotiations with Cole Caulfield are going well. He's confident that the file will continue to evolve well, with a naughty / teasing smile.
Who said that? Marc-Antoine?
Marc-André Perrault.
Oh, okay. That guy. Yeah. Okay. That's cool.
I just feel like Cole Caulfield, like, listen, I would like $8 million and 3 dirt bikes. And they're like, no dirt bikes.
And they're like, well.
$5 million and no dirt bikes.
Oh, yep, nope. Yeah, that is one of the RFAs for the Habs for sure.
Yeah.
On top of those are the RFAs, that's the important one. Then important UFAs, Paul Byron, Sean Monahan, Jonathan Drouin. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of that. And then whatever the fuck Pierre-Luc Dubois decides to do with his contract coming to an end as well. Yeah. And people are so on top of that.
I'll pass.
Holy cow. Pass. I didn't realize the guy's only 23.
Yeah.
He's a kid.
And he's problematic everywhere he goes.
Well, look at where he played. Columbus, Winnipeg, both places are pretty much cesspools of the worst possible. Well, Chicago. He hasn't played in Chicago, at least.
Yet. Yeah, fucking professional.
Yeah. Well, I mean, he hasn't skipped a team meeting.
2 minutes left. 2 minutes. Then he fucking scored 2 goals.
Yeah, well, there we go. Canadiens celebrated Indigenous cultures on Saturday night. That was for the Columbus Blue Jacket game, where they murdered the last place team in the NHL in stunning, embarrassing fashion. I was there. I was also high as a kite.
Oh, yeah, you were. That's right. Oh, fuck.
Oh, yeah.
What is it like to be high at a Habs game?
Woo! Let me tell you. So I had 2 pieces of edible candy. And I was like, all right, this is all right. I get to the security, right? So it took, 20 minutes by metro, 10 minutes to metro, 20 minutes at the actual Bell Center. And I'm looking at the security guard. I'm like, why does he want me to take my money out of my pocket? I don't know what it was. I was like, this is new to me. But I was going for it. Third period. I didn't watch the first 10 minutes of the third period because I was hunched over in the side.
Oh, like, no.
I am really high right now.
You can't have 2 candies.
I thought, I was looking at the measurements, and I was like, how much do I take of the other stuff? No. And I was like, I'm just going to take them both.
2 hours ahead of time.
Listen, there was 8 of those things in the package thingy.
Son.
And I took 2 of them. And now I know. I only need 1. Good game, though.
You're not a large person.
From what I recall...
it was fucking fun. It was fun.
They murdered them. I couldn't believe it. I was like, damn, this is really
shit. The first period ended even, right?
Yeah, that was the thing. I think they were, either way. With it becoming a barn burner, did not expect it.
Yeah. It was great. Everybody scored.
It was like, I
scored a goal.
It was the worst possible time. To be high, because I think a lady was escorted out because we were in the 400s. Like, I think a lady got escorted out for flashing the camera or something.
Oh, shit.
Like I remember the security guard being like, "Hey," and I look up, fetching young woman. I was like, holy crap, those were almost out. And I'm like,
almost?
What did I miss? But me being like, Cheech and Chonging it, I was like, damn. Cool. Anyway, it was a good time, though. It's always a good time at the Bell Center. Importantly, as mentioned, Indigenous Celebration Night at the Bell Center. They had special jerseys put up in very
beautiful.
Yes. Oh, yeah. As always.
The freaking Calgary Flames. So the Calgary, these are, it's their pride jerseys, but there are rumors from people who know things on Twitter that they're going to be selling t-shirts of their pride jerseys. And I'm like, if the Habs would make so much money, all hockey teams would make so much money if they sold their, especially warm-up shirt jerseys or shirts.
Yeah.
For both Pride Night, Indigenous Night. And I think it's, is it the Canucks have so many like cultural.
Every game.
It does feel like every game. Like they did, what is the color festival for? Did they do a whole? I think it was Holy. No, I don't know.
Max isn't here. I could ask him
before I dig myself into a hole. But like the Canucks always have like gorgeous warm up jerseys for like all of these different things, like all of these holidays and special occasions and stuff for different cultures. And like the fans want them. And you can like, I know like the auctions for the jerseys like go to charity, whatever. And I'm like, they could still make a lot of money for charity if they sold them as t-shirts.
Oh yeah,
I don't understand why the teams don't do this.
They, because I have Pride Habs stuff, like my hat. Love my hat.
Well, I have my mug.
Okay, well, honestly, the Habs Pride jerseys have been rather lackluster. I've been talking to some of my queer patriots about this. Just like a lot of times it's just like the flag and the logo. While other teams do like really fun stuff, but like the like the Calgary ones, they nature stuff and like birds and plants that are native to Alberta, but done in colors based off of the pride flag, and they're gorgeous. And I really hope that they sell them because I want one. But like the Habs Indigenous Night jerseys, like those are beautiful.
They are beautiful.
I love them, and I want a shirt or something that has it on there. But like, oh, and like a lot of teams throughout the NHL, they're like, okay, you can maybe, if you are in the upper echelon of our fans, you can potentially auction, you can purchase this jersey at auction. Otherwise, you're fucked. Have fun with the picture. That's it.
You know who else had a great Pride jersey? Florida Panthers.
Yes.
Florida Panthers. Yes, and that's when Mark Stahl
lied.
And the fucking, his
brother.
Oh,
yeah. That was a weird thing. I've never, ever worn a Pride jersey in my life. It's like, dude, that was not a Skittles jersey in Montreal.
Sure, nope, that's not me.
Yeah, so fucking weird. Like, man, it's like, I loved Mark Stahl, and now I'm like, fuck him, idiot. Just, yeah, that's all it takes. That's all it takes. If you're a bigot, you're a fucking moron. See you later.
Yeah.
Jesus.
And it's what we were talking about last week. The same thing with James Reimer. It's like, don't hide behind your fucking book of shit.
Yeah.
And what's amazing about that,
other rules that you don't fucking follow to guide your entire, you know, life.
And also,
don't hide behind your fucking book. Just sit it out and just be a bigot. I'd have more respect for you.
And like they come from a country where like queer people have been more widely accepted and been able to live their lives and have rights and freedoms that they deserve as human fucking beings for years and years longer than the United States. Like, grow the fuck up.
Well, you know what I think about that?
I wish
they probably secretly want to kiss a guy.
I wish that like if a player didn't want to participate, they didn't participate, but it wasn't like a whole spectrum coming out of it because they're centering the wrong thing.
Yeah. And then it's like Pierre LeBrun had a really good article about it in The Athletic stating how, you know, these players tried to, you know, not necessarily make it about themselves, but, you know, sort of did. But then the team still went out and did the right thing. And the team mates still went out and did not the right thing. But it's just like, I have never met a man confident in his own sexuality, confident about his heterosexuality, confident about who he is, who has any fucking problem with gay people or trans people or what the fuck ever.
Reimer has a small penis. What, it shows like, whenever he speaks.
What the fuck do you care? Yeah, why is it such a big deal to you that you have to bring God into it and the Bible and make yourself out not only to be like just to be better than, but also delegitimizing all of these people? Like, you're delegitimizing them.
Like, I have issues.
Who the fuck are you?
Like, I have issues with the police and the military, and honestly, my country, the country that I live in as a whole. So I don't participate in the Star Spangled Banner, and I generally don't participate in the military and police recognition when I go to sporting events. I don't make a big deal of it. I just sit there. I'm polite. I'm not rude.
Yeah.
I just sit there. I just don't participate. And if other people don't like it, that's fine. Nobody's ever said anything to me about it. And if they do, I don't give a shit. I am perfectly allowed to sit my ass in my fucking seat that I paid for. My cold plastic chair and sit my $19 Coke and wait for the clapping to be done.
Yeah. It's your thing, right? But you're not trying to, by doing that, you're not, like, by not at being an active participant, you're not deliberately, like, saying that these people don't count.
Yeah, I'm not trying to make it about my, I'm not making it about myself. It's not about me. It's not.
Because it comes across as preachy. I'm not doing this because the Bible said these people are bad. Yeah. So it comes across as too, like, it's a double intention.
And, like, there are so many players who are Jewish and Muslim and probably other religions that don't get talked about because we are so inundated with the whole white Christian dude that plays hockey. And, like, my thing is, like, why do we never hear you speak about this at any other time?
Don't, like, see you saying a prayer before you shoot the puck there, pal.
Yeah, like, you work on Sundays. You, a lot, like, you wear mixed fabrics.
Never seen a lot of Ash Wednesday during hockey, ever. Yeah. Never see players going out onto the ice with a fucking cross on their forehead, ever.
And I wonder who is Catholic. That'd be interesting. Or
and that's the whole thing too, is that they're by bringing the Bible into it, it's kind of putting themselves above, you know, I'm untouchable because the Bible, this is my book and I do what it says and this is all this stuff. But it's also like you're trying to say that there's something wrong with these people and twisting it into a thing that it is not. Like Brian Burke said on Saturday night, nobody's asking you to sign a form or convert to fucking homosexuality by putting on a jersey that says everybody's welcome here. That's what it is. They've twisted it into this other thing so that they can then have their excuse for their bigotry.
Exactly. Like there are, like if they had like a Muslim like recognition night or a Sheikh night or a something for a Jewish holiday, like Passover is next week and whatever. Like I know at least I think it's Mormons, like you're not allowed to wear like emblems from another religion or whatever. But it makes me wonder like how many of these people opting out of the Pride night jerseys would be so quick to say, oh, I can't, or I won't do this due to my religious beliefs. Like, but we see like all of these other players who are from other religions being like, oh yeah, it's fine. Give it to me. I'll put it on.
They're literally paying customers. You're the fucking product. You're the fucking entertainment.
Exactly.
You know, like and so they had to bastardize the whole concept of hockey is for everyone. Because they are just so fucking insecure. Like nobody's asking you to endorse. And Mark and fucking Eric Stahl, it's not a choice. It's not how people choose. It's not. Piece of shit.
If sexuality was a choice, no one would like men. So.
Just saying.
Yeah, like, I didn't choose to make my life more complicated. Than I'm already brown. I already am a woman. I already have mental health problems. And I already live in the United States. I'm not going to be like, oh, let's add something else.
Yeah, let's add this thing that's going to marginalize me and make people treat me like shit and possibly put my life in danger and all of this other shit. Like, let's choose to do
Choose. Like, I mean, like, masochism is all is fine and dandy, but like, not to that level.
Anyway, dead to me.
Yes. Dave, are you good?
Yeah. I'm straight and white. I can pretty much sum up everything in saying everybody that doesn't like gay people can go jump off a fucking cliff and die. Fuck them. Yeah. Conversation over. Their opinions, no matter if it's based on their own personal experience or faith, which is also bad, can go fuck off. Your opinions do not matter. Because these people exist. They've existed for thousands of years. They've existed before the fucking Bible. And they're still going to keep fucking the way that I want to. I'm sick of it. Fucking ridiculous. James Reiner can go get hit by a fucking bus and lose another playoff round for all I care.
If you disagree with gay sex, don't have it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Gay sex seems super lame to me. You don't see me wearing a shirt about it.
Problem solved.
Problem solved. Don't want to get gay married? Don't get gay married.
Don't get gay married.
God.
Pretty easy.
I want to see somebody being forced to gay marry. And I'm like, wow, this is really traumatic. Not going to happen.
I've never read a fan fiction about Reimer and Mark Stahl having to get married.
I don't think anybody should get married. Just FYI.
Yeah, by the way, yeah. It's a grift. Marriage is a grift. Sorry, everybody.
I'm going to go back into my my middle school fan fiction writing. And for tax and insurance purposes, Reimer and Mark Stahl are going to have to get married.
Meshach with the empty goal for Laval.
That's probably their whole hang-up.
Yeah.
But secretly, they want to be gay married. And have gay sex.
It's amazing what gets searched for in the, not Beltway, the Southern states when it comes to porn. Whole lot of butt stuff. Whole lot of butt stuff.
Butt stuff.
According to, Pornhub, which I think are a good... And I haven't watched that documentary, by the way.
I still haven't either. No, I haven't either.
Anyway, Promo gets sent down... Promo gets sent back down to the Rocket. New news, so he's down. See you later, pal.
Again, tonight?
Thanks for the loss. You're out. The Rocket... Rocket win their game. They are now back in the playoffs for the AHL. Good for them. But they have to keep winning. They have, I don't know how many games left. 8, something like that. Not very many. Where are they at? Games remaining. 8. Maybe 7 after tonight because these websites are so wonky. Either way.
Can you guys hear me? Is this
my We can hear you. What's going on?
Who are we talking about? The Rocket or the Habs?
The Rocket, yeah.
Let's just talk about the Rocket. Kevin Promo goes to the Rocket. Rocket win their game. They're back in the playoffs. Habs are not in the playoffs by any stretch of the imagination. They're actually eliminated officially tonight, I think.
Yes.
Yeah.
So that big question has now been put to rest. We can now focus solely on the draft. Finally. We are late to the party, apparently. Here.
And Jordan Decker, I owe him $200.
The hell did you do?
I bet him. Well, so at the beginning of the season, I made a joke about how how I was gonna laugh my ass off when the Habs made the playoffs.
Yeah.
And he made a bet, and I took it.
Yeah.
So I think I'm gonna have to pay in installments. He's been tweeting me, Jordan Decker. If you're listening, I'm good for it.
She is good for it.
I just don't know, how soon I'm getting, it's tax season and all that shit right now. Mm-hmm.
I got money left over from Chez Pare that I got to figure out how to exchange because all the exchange places were fucking closed on the way back here. Yeah. That is such a pain in the ass. I swear to Christ, man. Oh, my God, such a pain. Because Bank of America doesn't just do it for you. They need a certain manager. Then you have to fill out fucking paperwork. Oh, my God. I'd rather kill, not myself. Anyway,
What's the worst name? Bank of America or Royal Bank of Canada?
Bank of America, easily.
Bank of America.
Is that worse? Yeah.
Easily, yeah.
So my local, I just got an email from my local AHL team. They're having regrettable tattoo weekend Friday and Saturday.
You have one?
Jesus.
A regrettable tattoo? No. Yeah. I don't regret any of my tattoos. No.
However, now's the time.
Now's the time. But the Norfolk Admirals on the search for the most regrettable tattoo in Hampton Roads. That's what they call the metropolitan area of seven cities I live in. If you think you have a good one, enter the contest before Friday. The winner gets a free tattoo removal from a local tattoo removal place.
I have a girlfriend.
I've never seen this. Like, why have a promo?
I have a girlfriend who at the age of 14.
No.
At the age of 14.
Tramp stamp.
No.
Okay, good.
She got into the back of this dude's van and she got a tattoo of a tiger across her breast. A tiger. 14 years old.
And fantastic. Like
huge.
Oh my gosh.
And it was just like a big, like I was, anyway, she showed it to me. It was good work for the back of a van, quite honestly, but 14 years old. And when she was like 35, she got it removed. Most painful experience of her life. And it took like several sessions.
Yeah.
And it doesn't look brand new after.
All I'm thinking about is the tattoo scene from Bridesmaids. I think it's Bridesmaids.
Is that before or after the
one time? So I don't quite recall.
Was that before or after the ass bleaching?
Yeah,
it's before that.
All right, yeah.
I remember the diarrhea in the bathroom.
With the British roommate, the girl British roommate gets like the tattoo on her back in a van, and it looks, she like puts like a bag of frozen peas on it, or she's trying to, but then like falls off.
I don't remember.
I don't know. I think it's Bridesmaids. Somebody will correct us.
Yeah,
they're probably yelling at us right now.
Let's see, Sean Farrell, Shane Farrell. Sean Farrell. Yeah. 3-year contract signed, right? Oh, yeah, over the weekend.
Yes.
Entry level, but at over $1 million, which I thought was kind of weird because usually entry level contracts are like, you know, not over $1 million. So I'm kind of wondering what happened there or if entry level contracts can be whatever the hell you want. It doesn't have to be league minimum. So this guy got an entry level contract above the league minimum from what I can tell. And yeah, I guess his career started today. Unless he played in Buffalo, but I don't think he did. I don't think he played in Buffalo.
So, hold on. How old is this? Because this... Okay, this is from 2020, but it says the maximum salary is $925,000.
Yeah.
Yeah, so that's weird. I got that from the Habs news article saying that it's like... it was like $1,125,000. Instead of like the league minimum entry level contract. I wonder what Cap Friendly has to say about that.
Yeah. Asterisk. Yeah.
As of 2022, Cap Friendly says $925,000. Oh, but they can include signing and performance bonuses, so the player can make an amount that exceeds the $925,000, but there are still limits to that. The signing bonuses, according to Cap Friendly, may not exceed 10% of the contract's total, and that is paid to the players annually.
That bonuses probably maths out then.
$2.85 million.
Interesting. It also, I don't know actually if that also, I don't know.
Performance bonuses don't count towards salary cap.
And apparently,
wins.
Yes.
And apparently, the maximum potential performance bonus is only $25,000 only. So
only. Get imagine
get those points, boyo. Wow, it's something else. Anyway, good for him. Next is Nuki, NHL's second star of the week. 8 points in 3 games. Holy shit. He also reached the 200-point mark last week. Good for him.
Missed on the fucking shootout last night.
Yeah, again. We can talk about that, too, because that was a wild time against Buffalo. Buffalo, who are dying to get into the playoffs for the first time since, I don't know, before COVID. Anyway, before the Trump administration. First time since, I don't know when. It's been like 11, 12 years, something like that. long time, at least a decade. Funny enough,
Darlene still hasn't been to the playoffs.
Neither has Eichel.
Neither has Eichel.
But now Eichel will be probably going to the playoffs with the Golden Knights. So good for him. So, the thing about Buffalo that I always like to think about is that I like it when things don't change. Leafs eliminated in the first round all the time, naturally. Buffalo never making it to the playoffs, no matter how hot the beginning of the season is for them. Because remember, they usually have these 8 or 10 or 12 game winning streaks, and then they fuck it up. And it's amazing. Yeah. I love it every time.
Awesome. Yeah.
In 2020, this thing called COVID-19 happened, ended the NHL season, for those that don't remember. So the season was suspended on March something. The Habs at that time were sitting at a 50% win rate, which was the cutoff for getting into the playoff bubble that later resumed later that year. The team that was at, like, I don't know, 49 or 48% were the Sabres. And the Sabres were supposed to play against the Habs the very next game in the regular season if it was allowed to continue. So, Habs could have won that game, whatever. Or the Sabres could have, and they could have been in the playoffs.
Yeah.
Fast forward to March 27, 2023. Buffalo is aching for a playoff spot and go up against the Habs, the lowly, dreary Habs, and they are forced to a shootout. Buffalo gets a point, but they need two. Oh, they need those 2 points. Martin St. Louis in the shootout does what any, you know, coach of the Habs would do, and that is, we're gonna get Nick Suzuki out there. Misses. Oh God. Nick Suzuki can't score a shoot-off goal to save his life anymore. It's over. Can't do it ever again. Jonathan Drouin saved. Okay, whatever. Then things went off the fucking rails. Mike Matheson takes a shot. Saved. Then Jack Quinn for Buffalo scores. Oh, shit. Now it's sudden death.
Yeah. Oh, fuck.
Next up, Jesse Ilonen. Okay. Makes more sense. Offensive guy. Kind of fancy when he wants to be. Maybe not known for it, but still, there were other options. Scores a goal, Jesse Ilonen. Followed by Casey Mittelstadt. Miss. Then, Jonathan Kovacevich, another defenseman, goes for the shootout goal. And I don't know what the hell he was trying to do, but he just ended up running into whoever it was there. Comrie. That's the guy's name. Comrie there.
Yeah.
Followed by Dylan Cousins, who Jake Allen says no to. And then, goddammit, if Martin St. Louis doesn't put out fucking Michael Pezzetta for the shootout. Like, you have Rafael Javi-Pinard, you have Denis Gurianov, you have Gallagher, Chris Turney, Jake Evans probably would have been great. Kirby Dach, if he could have played as well. You got, like, you know, our goal scorers. Michael fucking Pezzetta with his fucking hair skates out there, nets it, and then rides the stick in celebration, you know, finger gunning along the way.
Yes.
Just.
Yes.
Absolutely.
So perfect.
Wild.
I love him so much.
Absolutely wild. I love him so much.
Italian stallion.
I thought my favorite shootout winning goal was when Ilya Kovalchuk won it in Jersey and told the crowd to. I thought that was the best one.
No.
This might be it because of it. Simply how unnecessary it had to be for everyone in Buffalo that was like, oh, no. Granted, lots of Habs fans there at the same time, but good for Michael Pezzetta.
And I felt it, like, my boyfriend's like old school hockey dude. Mm. Like, he's like, he always gets mad when people are just like, swish, 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 swish. Just like, just fucking drive in there and fucking shoot the puck. And that's exactly what Pezzetta did. And, like, as soon as I saw him just going, I was like, oh, he's gonna score. Mm-hmm. And like, not only that, like the Tiger Williams thing.
Yep.
The Tiger Williams thing. It was just, it was so perfect. He was so happy. And his teammates loved it.
Oh my God. Yeah. This team.
Oh, they fucking loved it.
It is, oh my God. It's a bit of a talk of what's going on is that this team ain't that good. They can be.
No.
But they're having a lot of fun. And apparently, according to Reddit, I read this on Reddit somewhere, is that folks around the league, players included, are have their eyes on Martin St-Louis and what he's doing with the team. So maybe it'll be finally a good place to play for, since Montreal for the longest time was not. It was decried as too heavy of a place to play or something bullshit like that.
I think a lot of that honestly has to do with also like Anglo quote unquote management. I think a lot of that has to do. I think that in a way, players who didn't necessarily have any kind of roots in Montreal or know how to speak French or that kind of thing, they might have felt kind of like that's almost going to play for another country kind of thing. Mm-hmm. I think that Kent Hughes and Jeff Gorton have kind of softened that part of them culture for a lot of people. Nick Suzuki, like all of these, like previously Shea Weber and Carey Price were a huge draw, but like you've got like these like super exciting young talent that
it's a rebrand.
Best ice in the NHL again.
That's right. That's another thing. The NHLPA Players Voters Awards. First time I haven't seen Carey Price mentioned in one of those.
Yeah.
That's too bad. But yeah.
He was there Saturday.
But now the Habs in general are they feel a lot more approachable.
Yeah.
And they're Shea Prey.
They're Shea Prey.
They're Shea
Prey. It's amazing, man. Some of these ladies, man, they fucking make bank. Can't believe it. Oh, like she's coming out again. Bam, hooked up somebody else. Wow, good job.
Oh my God.
Incredible. Incroyable.
I have a friend who was a dancer for 4 years.
And she just...
She went to dance in Japan. She came back, she fucking bought a house. Bang, bought, paid, no mortgage. You know, bought herself a yoga business. Like,
and like... In Japan, it's like a totally different thing too.
So much money, so much money.
That's
so
awesome.
Much money.
Them Japanese and any tourists, they can spend. They can spend.
Yeah.
They can spend. So nice. we might as well just become a strip club podcast at this point. I will go to all of them. Yeah, recommendations.
They pay for university.
Yeah, seriously.
You fucking made it ridiculous. She bought a house in Burnaby, not Vancouver, but outright.
Yeah.
Outright.
Easy. That's awesome. I'm proud of your friend. I'm proud of you too as well, but I'm also proud of Veronica's friend.
Yay. Yeah. I'm working till I'm dead. I'm never gonna retire.
Damn it.
Just FYI.
Damn it.
Yeah, probably same.
And I ain't no dancer.
I keep seeing things on TikTok and it's like all of these like people getting closer to retirement age and they're like, I can't retire, so my end of life care plan is to go to prison.
Yeah.
They're like
free rent, free food.
Food paid for, rent paid for. Because a lot of times, like if you are destitute or whatever, or like they take away your assets if you need financial support for end of life care, so they take away all your assets. So then, like your family doesn't get even what you had.
Well,
I have not done research. This is just what these people that are on TikTok talking about this are saying.
Yeah, TikTok
sucks.
I'm
by no means an expert. I'm not an expert.
There's a bill with being incarcerated. According to, what was I watching? John Stewart. And he said the problem with incarceration. And yeah, people that, are eventually let out because they've reached the end of their, their sentence.
Yeah.
And they finally, get whoever it is that mentions, okay, yeah, they're fine. They can be released back into society. There is a debt that they have to pay back at some point to everything that they accumulate. Like somebody said they got out and they're like they owed $80,000 to the penitentiary.
That's fucking bullshit.
Watch yourself that episode of Jon Stewart. It was quite eye-opening because I had no idea that that sort of stuff happened. Now, of course, all the writers were like, yeah, we're getting money back. It's like, well, they need to do that anyway. But let's talk about some games.
And the fucking board of governors or whatever of the prisons, they're all fucking...
Oh, yeah. It's a grift.
They're the ones that are making bank.
It's a grift. Everything's a grift.
I can't for-profit prisons.
Oh, yeah. America.
Jesus Christ.
If you're not going to pay taxes... We're going to pay somehow the way.
13th is a very good, 13th was full of, like, I'm embarrassed by everything that I did not know. But 13th, the documentary on Netflix and the culture of incarceration.
Oh, yeah.
Black people. And it's like the first thing that they did to them after they freed them as slaves, but they threw them all in prison. They threw them all into jail. And that's what I was saying to Robbie. Like, this shit is, it's so, like, the white supremacy thing. It's like, white supremacy?
It's the Puritan way.
All you did was come over and fucking steal land, and you were too lazy to work it, and you got these people to do it all for you, do all your work for you. They're fucking better at sports, they're better looking, they're better at music, they're better at dancing, you know?
Like, the food is better.
The food is better. It's just like, it's this whole thing. It's like this, what the whole white supremacy thing is such a lie. Such a lie.
Yeah. It is.
You know, about getting sunburned. Congratulations. Have fun with the skin cancer.
Yeah, it's a wonder that we've been around for so long. I say we as like the royal we, like, the
all
white
you did
we.
Was fucking be lazy and steal land, and you think that you're better than everybody.
Mm-hmm.
Like, no, dude.
Nope.
Anyway, I feel very strongly about it.
I've been saying it ever since 2016, and I've been telling you the states it's been white supremacy for a while. You look at Oklahoma City bombing.
I never realized
the first
very naive. I'm very sorry.
The first World Trade Center bombing. Those were all Nazis, or if not that, white supremacists. It's been around for a while. Charles Lindbergh. If he won the presidency before World War II, it'd be a completely different country. Oh, there were Nazi rallies in Madison Square Garden. Madison Square Garden, New York City. Nazi, fucking swastika in MSG. I mean, I get it, the Rangers now. But anyway, that was just the case, though. I mean, it's prevalent. It's in the fucking Blues Brothers as a gag.
Illinois Nazis.
Fucking Illinois Nazis. I hate those guys. But further to that, they're allowed to do that. Can't have a drag show, though.
No.
It's coming down the pipe.
Heavens, no.
Going to have a reckoning soon. Tampa Bay loses to the Canadiens 3-2 last week. Oh, yeah, March 21. Kirby Doc, Jonathan Drouin, and Mike Matheson, goal scorers. Brayden Point and Pat Maroon. That's so ridiculous. The Lightning looked terrible in that game. But also, the Habs, man, when Doc and Suzuki are the 1-2 for the center position, dude, that's a one. Yeah. It levels the playing field so well for the Habs for the top six there. It's really nice. But didn't last forever.
Is it me or are the Lightning getting old?
The Lightning are old. They also traded
like the longest seasons of all of the teams for like the last fucking 5 years.
That's true too. Long playoffs, not a lot of time off.
And they are old.
Yeah.
But they better fucking get it back together. The other thing is that the Leafs have been pretty, they've been kind of shitty, kind of iffy. Like,
yeah.
At a time where they shouldn't be looking iffy.
Well, that's what happens when you trade half your team for half of a new team a month before the playoffs and you don't get a fucking goalie. Wasn't Mimesso saying that about Buffalo the other night too, saying that they're just a goalie away from being decent, or if it was someone else during the intermission? I was listening to the radio on the way back from Montreal, so I can't remember who it was.
Yeah, Momo, he talks in the first intermission.
Mm-hmm. Momo's cool. Game against the Bruins. Habs get two power play goals against the Bruins.
Imagine.
Nick Suzuki and Kirby Doc for the goals. But
oh, yeah, the Bruins game. We didn't even talk about those motherfuckers.
Yeah, I don't even talk about the Bruins. Oh, yeah. What a fucking mess of a game that was. Like, just call the game. I can't even get into a ref rant right now. We don't have enough fucking time. But call the game. No. Buy the book. The book's there. The Bible doesn't... anyway.
Yeah.
You can't be you can be selective with the Bible. You can't be selective with the NHL rulebook.
NHL rulebook.
Oh yeah. My God. I didn't realize that Ottawa flummoxed the Lightning 7-2 last week as well.
Mm.
Holy shit. Anyways, Bruins defeat the Habs 4-2. Yeah, whatever. And look decent, the Habs. Jake Evans being back is amazing as well.
Yes.
Now, the game on Saturday that we talked about against the Blue Jackets, remarkable stat, the Blue Jackets won 62% of their face-offs that game. But as we know, they got fucking murdered. Brendan Gallagher scores. Rafael Harvey-Pinard, his hat trick in the second period.
Yes!
That's the second time in my life that I've seen Rafael Harvey-Pinard score a hat trick, which I can't think of like the last time that would ever happen. Yeah. If ever, I couldn't believe it. I was like, holy shit, he just got the hat trick and I'm flying right now.
Did you throw your hat?
No, I was not wearing my own hat.
I didn't.
No.
I
borrowed a hat.
I see them on TikTok all the time. I don't know if they're on other platforms, but there are some Francophone Habs fans that are on TikTok and they love RHB. They love him. And
naturally,
they like interview people with like a microphone like taped to a hockey stick, which I think is like a thing that several people do. But there was they were like outside at the Bell Center.
Habs TV.
They were Frank of Habs TV. I thought Habs TV was Anglo. I don't know. Maybe it was Habs TV. No, I don't, because I don't think it had. Anyway, it was somebody else. I don't.
It's bilingual. Habs TV.
It is okay. I don't know. But yeah. There's this guy like he just loves RHP so much, and he was like yelling at people like about still having their hats on outside the Bell Center after RHP got his hat trick. They're like, why? He was like, why do you still have your hat on? Like, but it was in French. But I was like, yes, you tell him, get rid of it.
You can go after the game and get it back. Or at least he used to be able to.
I don't know. I thought that either the players got them or they got donated to charity.
Oh, and somebody threw like a stuffed animal, like a stuffed toy. there's all kinds of stuff. Somebody threw a shirt. But it's just like, how can you not be happy for him?
Oh yeah, exactly. That guy. He's training camp. That'll be his next hurdle.
He's leading Martin St. Louis. Absolutely no choice.
Oh, yeah. No. He's on the top line of the Habs. Yeah. This Quebecer from middle of nowhere, Quebec, which is actually, where is he from?
Where is he from? Chicoutimi.
He is from.
Chibougamau.
He's from Saguenay. Saguenay. Yeah, that's out there. That's out. Yeah. That's way out there. It's like a 6-hour drive from Montreal.
Yeah.
Like
that's what do they call that?
Like you have to be careful driving that road. I don't know what they call it.
I've heard the TikTok, but I've liked so many TikToks today.
Also Alex Belzile, again, another great story with the Habs. Quebecer as well. Yes. And Nick Suzuki with the 8th goal. Man, oh man. Freaking killed him. Of course, who had minuses on the team? Joel Edmondson, Jonathan Drouin, and Denis Gurianov. Drouin went pointless in this game.
What?
Yeah. I guess we're just gonna have to put him away again. Too bad, so sad.
Back in the cupboard you go.
Yeah, back in the cupboard. Yep, game against the Sabres happened. That was embarrassing for the Sabres. Flyers, that was today. Embarrassing for everybody involved. And
I want to know why Rhett Pitlick has been a healthy scratch for 3 games. I am not happy about this.
Yeah, weird.
Man. Had to play the kid.
Yeah.
Had to keep Edlin in.
Turns.
I know, but yeah.
We're coming up on 300 episodes of the Habby Hour, by the way.
What?
Oh, wow.
Yeah. I mean, it'll happen next season, but We're at 272 right now. And also, thank you, listeners, we have topped 70,000 plays on Anchor since we started on Anchor. So that doesn't even include when we were on SoundCloud fucking dark ages.
Jesus Christ, back in the day. Veronica, you were right. It was Habs TV. Somebody else, it was on Twitter, not TikTok. Yes. Somebody else retweeted it, but it wasn't Habs TV. It was wasn't the original video. I'm sending it to the DMs. It's very good. And yes. I'll retweet it again.
Okay.
And we're out of time. We can either talk about TV or go.
I have not been watching anything new because I have been working ridiculous
hours. Oh my God. I hate myself. I've been watching Love is Blind season 4.
Sometimes you need some brain candy. It's okay.
Yeah.
All right. That's McDonald's.
Yeah.
As according to Jim Gaffigan. Yes. That's just McDonald's.
Oh, and I saw the season finale of Shrinking David. Did you?
Yeah.
I haven't watched anything yet, but it's
they're in trouble.
You're going to love it.
Oh, what a good show.
I can guarantee you're going to love it.
Veronica liked it from the get-go. It took me like 2 or 3 episodes, but after that,
from
I was
the
like,
start, I loved it. I've got a thing for Jason Segel.
Dave, you're like a cat. You got to warm up to things.
Yeah.
for those of you not watching, Dave did a cat impression.
You making biscuits.
Yes.
Or my cat when I walk by.
My ankles are destroyed because of my cat. He loves to hunt them. It's like,
for me. I see you. I see you. Like, fuck. It's not like I don't see you. Jesus Christ. Awesome. She's a character.
All right. Next game is Thursday night against Florida, which is going to be a fucking A. That's going to be a game.
Is that the Pride night? When is the Habs Pride night? It's coming.
Can we already have it?
No,
I don't think we did. We haven't had any players say that they didn't want to wear them. So
they wouldn't. Nobody. No, that's the other thing.
Watch Nick Suzuki.
Only shitty players
take off his pride jersey and set it on fire. Flip off a gay pride flag and just like walk out. It's like, oh my God, that was unexpected.
He's too cool. He's too confident.
Like, I stand by my son's decisions. And Rob Suzuki's like, well, I don't. Divorce. And it's, oh my God, I can go on with this. I can keep riffing.
No,
younger kids are just like, yeah. What's your fucking hang ups, you bunch of fucking boomers?
Exactly.
Yeah. I've heard a couple of Montreal fans talking about it, but I forget what the date is. But they said it's coming up, but they haven't had it yet. But Google is not helpful.
Okay.
So
cool.
If I find it, I'll post about it. But
that's like if Vancouver didn't have Pride Night. Like half of Vancouver, the population here, like we've got like a huge, huge queer population here. It's like if Vancouver didn't have one.
Oh, you guys are so gay.
So gay. We're very gay. Rainbow.
Cool. I guess that's it then. Goodbye, everybody. Next game's on Thursday, and we are in the final stretch. Now it's time to tank for Bedard.
Tank for Bedard.
Mm-hmm. Now we're on the tank train. Finally, with like 7 games left. Now we're in it. Let's go. How bad?